from the New King James Version, Psalm 18, verse 13 to 19. And it reads, "The Lord thundered from heaven, and the Most High uttered his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. He sent out his arrows and scattered the foe, lightnings in abundance, and he vanished them. Then the channels of the sea were seen. The foundations of the world were uncovered at your rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of your nostrils. He sent them above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy, from those who hated me. For they were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my calamity. But the Lord was my support. He also brought me out into a broad place. He delivered me because he delighted in me." Amen.
Good morning, church. Today's New Testament reading is from Revelations chapter 20, verses 1 to 3. Revelations chapter 20, verses 1 to 3. "I saw an angel come down out of heaven, having a key to the abyss and holding his hand a great chain. He seized the dragon, the ancient serpent, who was the devil or Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it over to keep him from deceiving the nations anymore until the 1,000 years were ended. And after that, he must be set free for a short time. And God add a blessing to his holy word. Amen."
Before we have prayer in the church, please, Dick, you're leading us in that. If I'm right, let's sing number 417.
Sweet are the promises, kind is the word, dearer far than any message man ever heard. Was the mind of Christ endless, I see. He, the great example, is a pattern for me. These are follow. Where leads, I'll follow. Follow Jesus every day. Tender love Jesus hath shown, sweeter far than any love that mortals have known. Kind to the erring one, faithful is he. He the great example is and pattern for me. Where he leads, I'll follow Jesus every day. Lift to his loving words, come unto me. Weary, heavy laden, there is sweet rest for thee. Trust in his promises,
faithful and sure.
Lean upon the Savior and thy soul is secure. Follow Jesus every day.
Would you bow with me, please? Our loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning as a group, as a branch of your church, to worship you. And Father, we thank you for this group of Christians here in this place. Lord, we know that at times it is hard to follow you closely. But we thank you for the encouragement that there is amongst the brothers and sisters of this congregation. And Father, we thank you for the work that Graham and Beth have done over the years on behalf of this congregation. We thank you for their commitment, for their consistency, for their long-suffering, for their ability to continue to work for you when life has not always been the sweetest. Now, Father, we ask that you be with them as they spend time in the United States, moving around the congregations who support them. We ask that you would guide them, that you would strengthen them, that you would help them to last out the pace of visiting different congregations, spending time with different people. Father, we think of them and we ask that you would buoy them up, that you would strengthen them, and that they may be able to continue, that they may be able to raise and continue to accept and have the support that they need to continue their work here. Father, Graham and Beth are two names linked closely with this congregation. But indeed, there are others also who have been founder members of this congregation and have been at its core for many years. We thank you for all of these people. We thank you that there is that kind of commitment, that kind of determination to strengthen, to guide, to encourage members here. Father, help each one of us to take on these kinds of responsibilities. Help us to watch out for each other, to notice each other, to speak to each other, to think of each other, and to pray for each other. Be with us as we continue through this day here. Be with Graham and Beth as they go through the first day of a new week with the congregation in the States. Father, guide them through the rest of their visit and bring them home safe too, as we pray. We ask that you would grant all these things in the name of our loving Savior Jesus. Amen.
Number 496, or listen to the wondrous story. This is another stand-up winner, it has to be said. So if you can, let's stand for this one, 496. And after this, we'll be led around the Lord's table.
Oh, listen to our wondrous story, counted once among the lost. Yet one came down from heaven's glory, saving us at awful cost, who saved us from eternal loss. What did he do? In heaven interceding, no angel could his place have taken, highest of the high though he, the loved one on the cross forsaken, was of the Godhead three, who saved us from eternal loss.
Son,
what did he do? Where is he now? In heaven interceding. Will you surrender to this Savior, to his scepter humbly bow? You too shall come to know his favor. He will save you now. Who saved us from eternal loss? What did he do? Where is he now? In heaven interceding.
Morning, everyone. Turn 46 this week, so I thought I'd do a wee kind of summary about what's happened in the world over the last kind of 50 odd years. And then I saw something last night, reading an article about 11:30. I thought, no, that's even better. I'm going to fix that in the morning. So what I tend to do is I've got all these thoughts running in my head. Sunday morning, I write them all down to make sure I don't forget anything. But this morning, as I'm writing this one down, I'm thinking I was going to do something else. I can't think what it is. And then when I opened in the class, started my phone, it came up and I was like, that's what I was going to change my Lord's table to. But anyway, I'm going to save that so you've got that to look forward to. We've all seen many different changes in the world, even those who are a bit younger than me. The first thing, I like the space race. So like in 1969, Apollo 11 launched, went to the moon in July. 1972, Apollo 17, the last moon mission, until this year when NASA launched Artemis, which is the first craft capable of carrying humans to the moon, which is currently possibly still at its furthest point. Then I saw something else. I saw apparently it's been 30 years since the first text message was sent. So in 1992, first text message was Merry Christmas. So I thought someone would get it, consider the amount of Christmas jumpers and socks that are in here. And that's led to many different technological advances. Like iMessage, you've got WhatsApp, you've got Snapchat, but all these kind of text services all originated in the first text message. 1995, I was finished first year at university. We had Oasis v Blur, surely the greatest pop contest of all time, unless you talk to the people who remember the Rolling Stones and the Beatles, who are real bands. You had Some Might Say versus Country House. It was all over the news. It's the kind of thing I didn't know Emma at that point, didn't know Anne, but you could imagine Anne going, what's this rubbish doing on the news? It's the kind of thing she would say when Sir Alex Ferguson left Man United. What's this? This isn't news. 1999, with the millennium bug, when the world was going to stop, because in 1980, when computers kind of came about, we couldn't be bothered putting eight numbers in a registry. We just had six to keep things nice and small. I then kind of thought about computers I've owned. I bought my first PC in 1990. Went to my mate's house with it. You had to lump massive monitors and stuff, and found out that my Pentium 100 was slowing everyone else's computer down, so I went and spent £200 about a month after I bought it on a Pentium 200, purely to play Quake or Command and Conquer or something. Just mental. 10 years ago, London Olympics. Remember, kind of Super Saturday where everyone was winning medals, gold medals were British. Think of the advancements we've had. Think of the phones that we had. I had a big list of phones that I've had. Nokia NK702, it could phone, it could occasionally text, it could hold 10 text messages. So, I mean, I've got more than that from probably people in the last day or something. So, also thought about the advance in computing, talked about the one I had. My mate had a ZX81, I had a Spectrum Plus 2, which is a computer, it had a tape deck added to it. When I bought my Pentium 100, it's 60 megabytes of RAM, and I bought a 60 megabyte graphic card, and it was running great. And nowadays, I talk to my employee as big into his computer. He's got like the 16 gigabytes of RAM on his memory card alone, 16 gigs in his PC, Intel i7. So we've seen all these kind of changes in the world, and some of us have seen great changes. Sometimes we think maybe in 5 years you don't see a lot of technology changes, but you start thinking back 10 years and you start to see, yeah, there is a lot's changed. I was thinking about 20 years ago, I taxied in East Kilbride. I probably knew virtually, definitely 95% of streets, if not 100%. I would know where they were. I knew where clubs, pubs, restaurants were. Nowadays, people phone me and say, I stay here in East Kilbride, and I'm like, I've got no idea where that is. But my mate told me he used to be a taxi driver. I'm like, who cares? Google Maps. You can find it, no bother. So I could go back to being a taxi driver with Google Maps, in all opinion. But amongst all this change that we've seen, we've got one thing that's constant, which should be our faith in God. And I wanted to look at Romans 8, verses 31 to 39. And it's a thing that talks about God's everlasting love. And through all these changes that we see in the world, this never changes. This is always present for us. And we're going to read through it, then we're going to pick out some of the points about it. So Romans 8 and 31 says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised. Who is at the right hand of God? Who indeed is interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we see this. So the first point I want to make is that if God is for us, who can be against us? And sometimes we need to remember that in our lives, because things can drag us down and try to take us away from God. We need to remember that Jesus Christ is interceding for us. He's interceding for you. He's interceding for me. We can conquer any challenges that are put before us by the world, but we've got to put our faith and our trust in Jesus to get through that. And if we choose Jesus and remain faithful, nothing can separate us from the love of God that we get through this. So when we think about this change of world that we have, when we think about all this advance in tech and things are always getting made better, as we meet here this morning to remember this everlasting love that God has had, we just use a simple remembrance. We don't need anything more because it was instituted by Jesus. So let's offer a prayer for the bread at this time. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we can meet as your church to worship your name. Father, we thank you for these moments of the week that we have to partake in a simple feast. We pray a blessing in this bread, the symbol of that of your son's body, which hung that cross for us. Father, we thank you for the love that brought him to this earth to put him on the cross, and it has to continually intercede for us when we continually do wrong. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray again. Heavenly Father, we offer a prayer of thanks for your son, for the love that you have for us, the sacrifice that was made in this earth. Father, we pray a blessing on every head that's bowed here this morning. Pray you'll help us to refocus our life, to refocus our commitment to you and to Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. I'll hand you back to Adam.
Number 147. And yes, we have to stand. Let's stand if you can. 147. Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. I marvel a wonderful, and my song shall end be high. Wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, but sweat drops of blood for mine. My song shall be he took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. And my song shall ever be. Marvelous, wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see, it will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love.
Good morning, church. Good to see everyone. The sermon reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. Matthew 7, 21, 23. I'm reading from NIV Bible. Not everyone says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the only one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, you did not prophesy in your name, and your name we drive out the demons, and your name we perform many miracles. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. This is the end of the reading. Amen.
Good morning. Thank you, Daniel, for reading that. Dick Van Dyke once described Mahatma Gandhi. He said, Gandhi walked barefooted everywhere, ate very little, and often fasted, leaving him thin and with very bad breath. Thus, he is often thought as super calloused, fragile mystic, plagued with halitosis. Get it? With the slow ones. Super calloused, fragile mystic, plagued with halitosis. Get it now? That's got nothing to do with my sermon. I was once told that if you're going to present a long sermon, you start off with a joke. But that joke didn't go well, so this is going to be a very long sermon for you all. Who wants to go to heaven? But I'd see more hands up. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be repaid for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. I'm ready. Are you ready for that trumpet sound? Are you ready for that final say? The final judgment? Your final destination? You see, I asked the question just before the trumpet sounded, who wants to go to heaven? And the response I got was what I expected. Most hands went up. I got some nods and I got some verbal responses. I expected that because, you see, heaven is our hope and our goal for the Christian life. And obviously, everyone wants to go to heaven. Or else we wouldn't be here today, right? We wouldn't be here, would we? I mean, we're here because we've heard of our Savior, Jesus, who came to die for us, and we believe and responded to that sacrifice by changing the way we live our lives and living according to what he's told us, right? And we want to spend eternity with our Savior and our Father in heaven, right? So if that's the case, then, why did Daniel read for us that serious warning in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21? Why does it say that? See, I don't get it. It doesn't make sense to me, right? Because surely everyone who calls himself Christian will go to heaven because they want to. They want to spend eternity with the one who saved them from damnation. Surely they realize that the life that we're living doesn't go in accordance with God. So they're changing it because Jesus told them to. Surely that's obvious. You see, one of the reasons Jesus needed to die was to show the extreme love he and the Father had for us. It makes sense to think that such an extreme display of love would give a positive response from everyone. But as Jesus' statements explains, most people aren't going to do that. Why? Why are most people not going to get it? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who calls himself Christian will enter the kingdom of heaven. You see, when I read that verse, I used to think, well, it's obviously not talking about me, right? It's obviously not talking about my family. It's obviously not talking about the congregation here. It's talking about the so-called Christians out there in the world, right? That's obvious. But Jesus says, only those who do the will of God will enter the gates of heaven. The only ones. In other words, Christians, his followers. But unfortunately, that presents a problem in itself, because the word Christian is used far too loosely in today's society. Far too many people use it as a temporary fix to kill their pain, to help them take away their problems. But brethren, I tell you what, Christianity is not a temporary fix. Christianity, a true Christian, it's the way of life. You know, I asked a person once who goes to a different church if they were a Christian. And they responded that, I'd like to think so. You know what? I appreciated their honesty. But you'd like to think so. I tell you what, if you don't know for sure, you better be doing something about it. Because it's better to be sure than to be sorry. And you know what? Maybe that's the problem. Maybe those of us who call ourselves Christians don't really know Christ. Maybe those of us who call ourselves Christians don't have a personal relationship with God. Maybe those of us who call ourselves Christians aren't really Christians at all. Maybe we're just almost Christians. Maybe we're pretty close Christians. Or partial Christians. But I tell you what, there's no such thing. You're either a Christian or you're not. What does it say in Matthew chapter 12, verse 30? Whoever is not with me is what? Is against me. It's all or nothing. You can't be a little bit pregnant. You can't be a little bit Christian. You know, you may appear at times that you are Christian, but an occasional appearance doesn't make you one. You know, people have all sorts of views and ideas, and most of them are based on their reasoning of two things. One, God is a God of love. And two, I am a good person. You ever spoken to someone that's made that statement before? God is a God of love, so why would he send me to hell? He's not going to do that. First of all, God doesn't send someone to hell. You know, I find it amusing that people still don't understand this. Even Christians don't understand this. Brethren, you decide where you want to go. But God's the judge. Surely he makes the decision of where I want to go. Yeah, you're right. God is the judge. And what does a judge do? They make fair and just judgments based on what? Evidence. And unfortunately, sometimes judges get it wrong. Or it can seem unfair, the judgment passed, because they're human and they don't have all the evidence. But not with God. Our God makes a fair, righteous, and just judgment based on the evidence, which is your life. The life that you're living right now. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, we read it earlier. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be repaid for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Well, people think that because they're not murderers or thieves or hardened criminals, then they consider themselves good people, and God will accept that. And you know what? We do it two at times, don't we? But brethren, look at what Scripture says. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 6. Proverbs chapter 6, and starting from verse 16, it reads. Look, we'll go through this list and see if any of them apply to us, right? Because we're saying we're not as bad as the hardened criminals or anything like that, but let's see what it says, right? There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes. Yeah, that's me. A lying tongue. Yeah, that's me. Hands that shed innocent blood. No, not me. Thank goodness for that. People that do that are the worst, are vile. A heart that devises wicked plans. Okay, me sometimes. Feet that make haste to run to evil. Yeah, it's me again. A false witness who breathes out lies. Me. Not as much, but still me occasionally. One who sows discord among brothers. Not me. Well, not really me. Don't we do that at times? Did you notice what I said about those that shed innocent blood? Thank goodness it's not me. People that do that, they're the worst. They're vile. Brethren, did we not shed innocent blood? Did our Saviour, who was what? Innocent? Not shed his blood for our sake? But how often do we do that? Yeah, my sins or struggles are bad, but at least I don't do that. How often do we attack each other and throw each other under the bus just to protect ourselves, to make ourselves look good? Yeah, I occasionally tell a white lie, but at least I don't sleep with my boyfriend or girlfriend like so-and-so does. Yeah, I occasionally swear when I get frustrated, but at least I don't do drugs. Yeah, I occasionally gossip and talk about other people, but at least I don't kill anyone. And you know what? We do it for the opposite as well. Yeah, she helps out at youth club, but I brought so-and-so to church. Yeah, he can lead some good songs, but have you ever heard me preach? Yeah, she does some Bible studies, but I know scripture off by heart. We do it when we're lacking something. Yeah, I forgot to pray this morning, but so-and-so didn't turn up for church last week. Yeah, I could have helped out, but I've always helped out, and so-and-so could have done it because they never do anything. Yeah, I didn't tell my friend about church, but did you see what so-and-so was wearing last week to church? Why do we do that? Why do we rank our sins? Why do we point out the speck of dust in each other's eyes when we get planks of wood coming out of our own? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Did we do that? How difficult it can be because of how difficult people can be at times. Mark chapter 11, verse 25. And whenever you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anyone, so that your Father... Whenever you stand praying, forgive. Forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father also who is in heaven may forgive your trespasses. Do we do that? You know what? Some people don't deserve my forgiveness, right? Matthew chapter 18, verse 21 to 22. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you seven times, but 70 times seven. 70 times seven. 490 times. You want me to forgive my brother? I'll tell you what, if someone is in need of my forgiveness seven times, we'll be lucky if they get it, let alone 490. Do we forgive? Or do we get sick of forgiving? Luke chapter 6, verse 37. Judge not, and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. How often do we judge each other? Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. You know what? This is a hard one, right? That one's a hard one. So maybe God will let us away with that. Maybe. Maybe just that one. Because we struggle with that, don't we? Luke chapter 6, verse 27. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. God, you're joking, right? You're joking. I have to do good to those that hate me. You know what? I struggle at times doing good to those that don't hate me. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 28. A dishonest man spreads strife, and the whisperer separates close friends. Are we ever dishonest? Do we ever tell a wee white lie? Do we ever plan out our lie? I know I have at times. And it's to people in this room right now. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 19. Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets. Therefore, do not associate with a simple blabber. Do we ever spread rumors to put others down? To make ourselves look good? Look better than they? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouth, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear it. Do we gossip? Here, I heard. Did you hear about this? No way. I need to go tell so-and-so. Here, come here. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 13. Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in spirit keeps a thing covered. Which one of these two describes you? Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are his delight. If we lie, sometimes, occasionally, when we really need to. Going back to our text in Matthew chapter 7. In verse 22, it says, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? Is that not what we just went through? But Jesus, did I not attend worship every Sunday? Did I not bring brother or sister to be saved? Did I not stand at the pulpit and preach and lead some to you? Did I not give to the poor? Did I not do this? Did I not do that? Did I not call myself Christian? And what will he say to many of them? Verse 23. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Don't know about you, but that verse scares me. He will say, I suffered for you. I bled for you. I died for you. Just so that you can turn around and say that you've done some good things. What did Isaiah say in Isaiah 64, verse 6? All our righteous acts are like what? Filthy rags. You think I died for you to give me filthy rags? I died for you so that we can have a relationship. A relationship where I told you plainly what I like and I don't. What I expected from you. What I wanted from you. I told you all and here. You had it in your very hands. You just never listened. You just never read. You just never done them. You never took the time to try and get to know me because you were too busy trying to impress me. You were too busy trying to impress others. I'm not looking for you to be impressive. I'm looking for you to press in to what I done for you 2,000 years ago. That sacrifice I made for you. Is that the way we're living? Because if we're not, the one in Matthew chapter 7 makes sense now. I didn't get it before, but now I do. If that's not the way we're living, we need to make change because it's better to be sure than to be sorry. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many may enter through it, but small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only few find it. You know what? That pretty much tells me the number of people that will be going to heaven. And it'll be tiny in comparison to those who don't. Brethren, we can't set the rules. God does, and they're not negotiable. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 25. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. Is living the life you want, being a part-time Christian, worth losing eternal life with God in heaven? Again, you better be sure, because if you're not, you will be sorry. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus makes it very clear. It is impossible to get into heaven on your own. It cannot be done without accepting him. Acts chapter 14, verse 12. Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. If Jesus tells us himself that he is the only way, then we must be what that word Christian truly means. And that is to be Christ-like. See, it's easy. It's easy to say we're not as bad as them. We don't do the extreme things. But there are things we do do. It tells us not to. It's easy to point the finger. But brethren, we've got to look at our own lives. And we've got to make a decision. We all want to go to heaven, right? We say it with our lips. But do we say it with our hearts? Do we live it in our lives? We're running a race. We're on the battleground. And we have all the encouragement and all the tools we ever need to win both of them. And unfortunately, there are those that have given up. Are we going to join them? Because it'll be a shame, because we're nearly there. Jesus is going to come like a thief in the night. Is it really going to be worth it leaving for a few moments of pleasure on earth? Are we going to drop our equipment? Are we going to get rid of the love and support that we have? Or are we going to keep the faith, finish the race, and fight the good fight? Because in the end, it will all be worth it. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to you. To you. To you. To you. To you. To you. And all those who have longed for his appearing. What will it be like when that trumpet sounds? When that judgment is called? Will there be cheers because we won the battle? We finished the race? Or sorrow because we left? Because we gave up? Will our pain be gone? Our worries disappear? Or will it just be the beginning of our eternity? Will he call our name with joy? Or will he call our name with regret? The moment we've been waiting for. Will he say, depart from me, I never knew you? Or will he say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, my beloved child. You have run the race and now you're home. We'll be able to spend eternity together. And we'll be able to say to our father, they're a part of the reason of how I got here. Where here will be is up to you. I love you all. And I know you all want to go to heaven. So I can't wait to spend eternity with you there. God bless you.
What will it be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face?
You.
Thank you for that lesson, Edwin. Very, very thought-provoking and great reminder. Let's stand and sing something a little bit again, if we'll. 948, stand again if you can. Let's be those who are resolved not to be those who God does not know, but who will hear those words. Well done.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, peace at my side. I will stand to enemies, so glad and free. Jesus, great as I am, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, great as I am, I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior each day. For he said, do what he will, and he is the living way. I will listen to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, I will come to thee. I am resolved to enter the kingdom, leaving the paths of thee. Friends may oppose me, foes may beset me, still will I enter it. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, I will come to thee.
Good morning. Anybody cold? I'm freezing. Anyway, it's time to give back some of the blessings that we've received since the last time we met. And I'm sure a lot of us have received a lot of blessings. Maybe you've received blessings that you didn't realize were a blessing, things that we take for granted. Well, I guess we're all guilty of taking things for granted at times. But when you look back what's been done for us in the past, not so long ago in the past, only maybe about 2,000 years ago, what a blessing. And we can grab onto that blessing and consider it ours, given freely to us. It's great to give something, a gift or whatever. When you see a child's eyes lighten up when he gets a gift, you know, or anybody, when you see the pleasure in their face. And then that inspires them, hopefully,
as they grow older, to give and to see the pleasure in faces again. When we look around us at what we've got here in Cumbernauld, this congregation, we can gladly say that we've been blessed, truly blessed. But Christ gave his life for us. That's the biggest thing that anybody will ever do for you. Probably nobody will, but Christ did for all of us, each and every one of us. When we were all sinners, in spite of what we were, he gave his life for us. And we are only asked to give back a small amount that will go to good use and spread that news. So as we do so, let's think how blessed we are and how blessed we will be. Paul wrote to the Corinthians and he said that God loves a cheerful giver. Let's have joy in our hearts and let's realize the joy that can be shared by giving. Please give generously. Let's pray. God, our Father, we thank you so much for the tremendous gift that we've been given, the gift of eternal life. We pray, Father, that we can finish the course. Be with us now, Father, as we give back in order that many people will be blessed through what's been given from this congregation. Be with us now, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Before we close in prayer, let's sing number 470. You know what we have to do. Let's stand if you can and remain standing for the closing prayer. 470, Victory in Jesus.
I heard an old, old story, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory, Jesus, my Savior, for he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and knew me. Punch me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Erase that a little bit.
I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory, Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, I knew him. And all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the street of gold beyond the grave. midst of sea, above the angels singing, and the old redemption's glory. And some sweet day I'll say up there that song of victory. Oh, victory, Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
If you'd like to bow with me at this time. Dear Heavenly Father, as we start this week, we acknowledge that you are God, you are powerful, good and gracious. Thank you, and we praise your great name. You are holy, and there is no other name under heaven by which we receive life and salvation except through Jesus. We pray for your protection as we begin each day new this week. You are our hiding place, and under your wing, we can always find refuge. Protect us from trouble wherever we go, and keep evil far from us. No matter where we are, we will look to you as our protector, the one who fights for us every day. We pray for health of mind and body so that when we suffer under sin, we can overcome and win the victory in you and bring glory to your name. Take our pain away and heal us according to your will in your perfect time. Let us go into the world with confidence, trusting that Christ is walking with us. And it is in Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen. Amen.